हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. वेलकम टू क्लास 11 बायो क्लासेस. ऑल्दो यू हैव नॉट कंप्लीटेड योर एग्जाम्स, बट यू आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट योर बायो क्लासेस फ्रॉम टुडे ऑनवर्ड्स. एंड आई थॉट ऑफ फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल स्टार्टिंग दोज लेसन्स विच यू आर गोइंग टू हैव इन योर क्लास 10th ऑल्सो, so that at least you will be having some revision of those topics in these classes, but you are going to study those topics in little more detail in class 11. So today I am going to start with the lesson transport in plants. So in the transport in plants, in your class 10th lessons you have studied about the processes which are helping in transportation. Those processes are osmosis, diffusion, imbibition, etc. So we are going to study about those processes and their mechanism in little detail. So our first process we are going to start, first of all let us know what is meant by the transportation. So a process of transporting Now, as I'm going to write the something on the board, I hope that you all are going to write somewhere in your, if you are provided with the books and copies, you better sit with the copy and pen and go on writing down whatever I am writing in the board, and whatever I am explaining, that also you try to write it. If you are missing some words, you can replay the video and complete the whatever I have said. So a process of transporting water, minerals, and food to all parts of the plant is called transportation. Now there are certain characteristics of the transportation that also I am going to write here, that conducting tissue that is the xylem and phloem is helping in the transportation. Then another characteristic is which substances are transported here. So the substances which are transported are the gases like oxygen, carbon dioxide, then water, minerals, then organic nutrients, and hormones, etc. Now, transport in plants occur in three levels. So, what are they? Transport in plants occur at three levels. Number one, the individual cells are taking the water and minerals like the root hair cell. So, uptake and release of water and solutes by individual cell means the cell is taking the substances inside and releasing some substances outside of it. For example, root hair cell. It is absorbing water and mineral from soil. Then second level is suppose the food is synthesized in the leaves and that food is taken through the phloem and distributed in all other parts of the plant. So that will be the second level of transportation. So that is the long distance transport of sap within xylem and phloem at the time of translocation of photosynthate from leaf to root. So, second level of transport is long distance transport. In this transport, the sap which is flowing in the xylem that is transported from root to the upper parts of the plant, and through phloem, the food which is synthesized that is transported from leaf to the root. So, that will be the photosynthate. So, all these are the long distance level of the transportation. Now the third level of transportation is long distance transport of substances from cell to cell. For example, loading of sugar from the mesophyll cells to the phloem cells in the sieve tube. So loading means the sugar is synthesized by the process of photosynthesis into the mesophyll cells. And then this sugar is transported to different parts of the plant where it has to be stored, where it has to be used for the process of getting energy. So this sugar from the mesophyll is transported. So when this sugar from the mesophyll cells is given to the phloem sieve tube cells to be transported, then this loading is called as cell to cell transportation of substances. So this is the third level of the transportation. Similarly, the cell-to-cell level of transportation can be the synthesis of any hormone. Then this hormone is synthesized in one cell and it is transported to the neighboring cells. Like this, the suppose potassium ions. Potassium ions, we have studied the potassium ion concentration theory about the stomatal opening and closing. So in that, what we have studied, that from the neighboring cell, potassium ions are taken into the guard cells, which makes the concentration of guard cells more higher, due to which the guard cells absorb water and they become turgid, and due to which the stomata open. So here also the transport of potassium ion from one cell is taking place into the other cell, that is the guard cell. So this is the third level of transportation. Then the transportation is of two types. One is the unidirectional type and the other is the multidirectional type. Unidirectional type, we have seen that from the roots the water and minerals are absorbed, which I have shown with the red color, and this water and minerals are going in one direction only, that is from down to above parts of the plant, and there it is distributed into different above aerial parts of the plant. So this will be the unidirectional transportation. Then the multi-directional transportation is also there, in which the food is synthesized in the leaves, the hormones are synthesized in the hormone producing cells, and then this food or the hormones are distributed in the upward direction also and into the downward direction also, into the lateral direction also. So it is going in multi-level direction. So this type of transportation is called as the multidirectional transportation. Now our next topic is imbibition. Now in the transportation or in absorption of water, two forces are working together. One is imbibition and the other is osmosis. So by the process of imbibition, water is attracted towards the cell, and then by the process of osmosis, water is absorbed inside the cell. So one is adsorption of water, that is the imbibition, and by the process of osmosis, absorption of water takes place. So what is imbibition? First of all, we'll be seeing. So imbibition is what? Adsorption of water by the solid particles of an absorbent without forming a solution. Means water molecule just adhere to the surface of the solid particle, but they don't make any solution into the with the solution solid particles. So cell membrane or cell wall, we can say cell wall is made of cellulose. The seed coat of the seed, that is also the made of protein layer, etc. So this protein, cellulose, etc., these are the substances which are attracting water towards themselves, and the water molecules adhere to the surfaces of these substances found in the cell wall. And by the formation of this imbibitional layer, then the water is absorbed inside the cell. So the substances which are showing the imbibition, they are called as imbibands. And the liquid which is being imbibed, that is the water, that liquid is called as imbibate. And due to the imbibition water of water increases the volume of imbibant, means the particle or the substance, that is the cellulose or protein, that when it is adhering the absorbing the water, then it increases the volume of the substance. So due to which pressure is created, and this pressure due to the increase in the volume of the substance by imbibition of water, this pressure is called as imbibitional pressure. Now, conditions necessary for imbibition. The first condition is water potential gradient between the imbibe end. Imbibe end means the substance which is adsorbing, and imbibe liquid, that is the imbibate, that is the liquid which is being adsorbed. So that water potential gradient should be there, means the difference in the potential of water should be there. One should have more water, one should have less water. Then another condition is force of attraction between imbibent and imbibate, means there should be force of attraction so that the water should be get attracted towards the imbibent. Then there should be increase in temperature, means if the temperature will be more, then only the imbibition will be more. Then the characteristics of imbibition. First characteristic is adsorption, means the imbibent adsorbs imbibate. Why it is absorbing? Due to great force of attraction between the two, means both are developing a great force of attraction due to which water is attracted towards the adsorbent substance. Then water potential, means the water potential of the two will be just opposite. Now water potential is what? Water potential means as many as water molecule will be there in a solution, that solution will be having more water potential, and as many as less molecules of water and more molecules of solute, that solution will have less water potential. So that is why we have seen in class 10 when we studied that the maximum water potential is of what? The pure water, and we consider it as zero. The maximum potential of pure water is zero. Now why we call it zero? Because there is no temperature, no atmospheric pressure working there, no other forces are working there, and all the molecules of the water are having their full energy used in the water. There is no adulteration, no other molecule of the solute, only water molecule. So large number of water molecule, only water molecule, so it will be considered as zero. Like in gravitational force, when we are falling the substance from up to down, it is falling down only. So the ground level is considered as zero gravitational force, means maximum gravity will be at the ground level, and as we go up, it goes on becoming negative and negative. So similarly, when we are adding the solute molecules in the water molecule, the potential of water goes on getting decreased and decreased, because the number of molecules of water in comparison to number of solute molecules, they go on becoming lesser and lesser. So the value of the water potential goes on becoming negative. So as much negative is the water potential, as much will be the less potential of water. So that is why water potential should be imbibent. Negative water potential should be less, means imbibent should be very dry. It should have very little amount of water molecule or no water molecule. And the imbibe weight, that is the water, should be having maximum potential of water. That can be zero also, means it can be pure water also. Then only the two water potential will get attracted towards one another, and so the water molecules from the region of their high concentration, that is the hypotonic solution, will move to the region of low concentration, that is the concentrated solution. So these are the two characteristics. Some other characteristics also I am going to write. Now the third characteristics is water potential gradient. As I told that the as much as less number of water molecule, as much as less will be the water potential. So a dry imbibant when comes in contact with water, so dry imbibant means very less water potential, and water, that is the maximum or highest water potential. So when they two come in contact, a steep gradient of water potential is developed, and this causes water diffusion very rapidly from its higher potential, that is from water, to its lower potential, that is into the imbibent substance. Then another characteristic is heat of wetting. When the imbibition takes place, heat energy is released during imbibition. So this heat energy which is released during imbibition, it is called as heat of wetting. We can see it in one example, that if we are soaking the seeds in water, the seeds are swelling up, and if we see the temperature of these seeds, we'll be observing that some temperature is rising when the seeds are swelling up. So this is called as the heat of wetting. Then the fifth characteristic is increase in volume, means when the imbibent substance adsorbs water, then its volume increases. This we can see with the example again, the soaked seeds. The seed coat absorbs water, it gets swollen up, and after that the water enters inside the seed, and the seed also absorbs water, and its volume increases. Then the swelling of wooden doors. You might have observed in your houses, in the rainy season, the wooden doors become little bit tight to fit into the frame. So this is due to the absorption of water by the process of imbibition. Their volume increases, so they are fitting with difficulty into the frame. Now as we have seen that when the volume is increased, when the imbibition takes place, the volume of the imbibent is increasing. So when the volume is increased, it exerts a pressure on the wall of the vessel in which the imbibent substance is kept. So that pressure which is being exerted on the wall of the vessel due to increase in the volume of the imbibent substance by absorption of water is called as the imbibitional pressure. Now all the substances do not absorb water, same amount of water. They are absorbing the water according to the capacity. So that capacity is called as imbibition capacity. For example, proteins, they are hydrophilic colloids, means they are attracting water towards themselves. so their imbibitional capacity will be maximum. Then lesser to the proteins is the capacity of starch to absorb water, and minimum is the cellulose, it is absorbing the least amount of water. So this we can see with the help of example of the seeds soaked in water. So when we are soaking the proteinaceous seeds like the pea seed, gram seed, when we soak them, they swell more, they become almost double or triple of their size. But when we are soaking the maize seed or the wheat seed, it is not swelling up to that extent because it is containing the starch in them. So that is why with this example we can say that imbibitional capacity is different in different type of imbibents. Then there are certain factors which are influencing the imbibition. The first one is texture of imbibent. So in the texture of imbibent, if the imbibent is having the loose texture, means there are the pores between the molecules, there are the spaces between the molecules, then it will be absorbing or imbibing more water. Then affinity of the imbibent for the imbibate, as we have seen, the proteins are absorbing more water, means the proteins have more affinity to the imbibate than the starch and the cellulose. Then temperature, when the temperature increases, the imbibition also increases, the rate of imbibition will increase because the energy will be increasing, kinetic energy of the molecules will increase, so more energy, more imbibition. Then the pressure, suppose the substance is kept here and there are the water molecules, and these water molecules are being absorbed on the surfaces like this, and this is the normal atmospheric pressure. So in the normal atmospheric pressure, the absorption is taking place normally. But suppose if we increase the pressure here and this is being compressed, we are increasing the pressure. So when the pressure is increased, the imbibition will get affected and the rate of imbibition will be reduced. So these are then the pH. In the pH, when the positively charged colloidal particles are there, the means the acidic pH, in the acidic medium the imbibition will be maximum, and in the alkaline pH the imbibition will be minimum. Now significance of imbibition. First is absorption of water by rule. Now by the process of imbibition, when the water molecules are absorbed to the surface of the root hair cell, then only they are absorbed by the process of osmosis, because of the cellulosic layer and the protein layer which is present into the cell membrane. So these proteins are absorbing, then the water molecules get attached to the protein, and then only the water molecule enters inside the cell. Then in seed germination, by the process of imbibition, the seed coat gets swollen up and burst out, it gets ruptured, and then only the radical and primule is able to come out. Then absorption in young cells. The young cells are absorbing the water by imbibition. When they become mature, then only they absorb the water by the process of osmosis. But when they are young, they are absorbing the water by the process of imbibition. Then, study of the skull bone. The sutures of the joints of the skull bones, when the skull is kept in the water solution, then the water is imbibed by the sutures, by the joints between the bones of the skull, and then only it is able, the researchers are able to break open the joints of the skull bones for the biomedical study. Then the development of fruits is also helped by the process of imbibition, because by the process of imbibition they absorb water from the cells of the neighboring parts of the fruit. Where the fruit is developing, the cells of the fruit are absorbing water from the neighboring parts of the fruit, and then only the cell in the fruit increases in size. So these are all the significance of imbibition. Then we come to the next topic, that is the diffusion. Diffusion, as we have studied, that in diffusion what happens, the molecules are moving from the region of their high concentration to the region of their lower concentration till the both the concentration become equivalent or in equilibrium. They maintain the equilibrium. So this is the process of diffusion. Then next we are going to study the characteristics of diffusion. Now in the characteristics of diffusion, we can see that diffusion is passive. Passive means it is automatically occurring when there is a difference in the concentration of the two types of molecules. So it is not using any energy, it is taking without energy passively due to the difference in the concentration, means due to the concentration gradient. Then the diffusion will continue till the equilibrium is maintained. Then it is occurring due to the concentration gradient, means when the difference in the concentration is there, then the molecules are going to move from the region of their higher concentration to the region of their lower concentration. Then it is occurring in molecules of liquids and gases mainly, and this diffusion is due to the random movement of molecules, and this movement is brought by the kinetic energy of the molecules, and this movement is also called as entropy driven movement, means when the movement is taking place due to the kinetic energy of the molecule, the molecules keep on colliding with one another and they are moving randomly, then this type of movement is called as entropy driven movement also. So these are all the characteristics of diffusion. Then we'll come to the special type of diffusion, that is the facilitative diffusion. This, till now we have studied about the simple diffusion, where the molecules are passing through the membrane, biomembrane, automatically through the channels, and no proteins, nothing is required for the movement of the molecule. They are just moving due to the concentration gradient. But some substances are there which require some channels, some assistance, something to help their movement from outside to inside or from inside to outside of the cell. So then this is called as the facilitative movement. So this is called as facilitative diffusion, and this diffusion takes place with the help of some special proteins, and these are the proteins or the group permeases. Permeases means they are increasing the permeability for the substances to be absorbed from outside to inside or from inside to outside. And so these proteins which are facilitating the diffusion of certain molecules, these proteins are called as the transporter proteins. So these proteins are not taking the help of any energy. They are simply binding to the molecule which need to be transported, and by binding to the molecules, these proteins are helping in their transportation from outside to inside. Now, transporter proteins are of two types. They are of two types, the carriers and the porins. Now, carriers they are changing the shape, they change their shape. And by changing the shape, they are transporting, means they bind to the, they change their shape, bind to the molecule, and helps in transportation. So this we can see with the help of this diagram. This I am drawing a bilayer, lipid protein bilayer, that is the semi-permeable membrane. So this is the biomembrane, and in the biomembrane, this is the cell membrane, the diagram of the cell membrane, and this red color will be the protein embedded in it. So this protein will get bind, and this is the outside of the cell membrane, and this is the inside, this is outside, and this is inside of the cell. This is the semi-permeable membrane. So this molecule get bind to the protein, that is the carrier protein. Then this carrier protein changes the shape, and it is transporting the molecule in this form. This is again the biomembrane, that is a semi-permeable membrane, lipid bilayer. And this will turn like this, and the molecule will enter into the cell. So this will be the inside of the cell, and this molecule which got attached outside, when the protein changes the shape, turns inside, the molecule is entering into the inside of the cell. So this is how the carrier proteins are helping in transportation of the molecules. Now, porins are the protein bound channels, and there are three types of channels formed by the porins. So the first one is aquaporins, and these are the channels which are made of proteins, and they are always remain open and they allow water diffusion into the cell. So water keeps on entering into the cell due to the concentration gradient. Means outside if water molecules are more, inside if water molecules are less, so they will be automatically getting inside through these aquaporins and they are entering into the cell. Then ion channels are also remain always open, and they are also allowing the movement of ions again due to the concentration gradient. Means outside if the ions are more, inside if the ions are less, then from outside to inside the ions keep on entering. Then the third type of proteins, porins, are the protein bound channels which are getting stimulated, means which open or due to the stimulus by any chemicals. So they open to respond for the stimulus, and if any chemical, any specific chemical comes in contact with these proteins, then only these channels are opening. So in this way, three types of proteins channels are there which are allowing the movement of molecules transported outside and inside of the cell. Now, types of facilitated diffusion. First one is unitransport. Means that one molecule is transported. So one molecule moves through the membrane. This we can show by this. Suppose this is the protein channel. This is the bilipid layer. Suppose this is outside, so in unitransport one molecule at a time moves from outside to inside or from inside to outside. So suppose these are the molecules which are to be transported from outside to inside of the semi-permeable membrane. So this is the protein. So this molecule will bind to it. And it will enter through this protein. So this molecule from outside enters into the inside of the cell in unidirectional, means from outside to inside, one molecule is moving. Then second type is co-transport. In co-transport, what happens? Two or more than two molecules are transported inside to outside or outside to inside. Now in co-transport is of two types, one is antiport and the other is semport. In antiport, what happens? Suppose there are the molecules inside and there are the molecules outside, both has to be transported. So what will happen? One molecule simultaneously will move outside to inside, means one molecule moves inside, see, at the same time the other molecule will move outside. So this is called as antipode, means two molecules are moving, but both of them are moving in the opposite direction at the same time. And in semport, what is happening? In semport, two molecules at a time move inside or outside. Two molecules move inside together or outside together. Then it is called as the semport transportation. So I have written the definitions here. Unitransport means movement of one molecule across the membrane in one direction only. Then co-transport, movement of two or more molecules across the membrane simultaneously, means together at the same time. Then co-transport is of two types, antiport. In the antiport, movement of two or more different types of molecules takes place through the membrane but in the opposite direction. For example, sodium potassium pump, means for every two potassium ions moving out, three sodium ions are entering inside. And pump means the protein through which the ions are moving across the membrane, that is called the pump. Then semport. In the semport, two or more different types of molecules move across simultaneously through our membrane but in the same direction. For example, absorption of minerals by root hair cell. So in the absorption of minerals by root hair cells, water molecules along with a lot of different types of ions are moving inside of the cell across the cell membrane. So this will be the semport, means different types of ions are moving inside together at the same time in the root hair cell by at the time of absorption of water in the root hair cell. Then second example is translocation of glucose by fluent cell, means when the glucose is transported by the fluent cell, it is transported along with the proton pump, means along with the protons the glucose is also being transported into the cells. So these are the examples of different types of means of transport by diffusion. Now, significance of diffusion. The diffusion have lot of importance in different processes of the plant. How? First of all, exchange of gases. It is the process of diffusion through which the gases are diffusing inside and outside of the plant. For example, during the daytime, carbon dioxide diffuses in the plant for photosynthesis, and oxygen is diffusing out of the plant as a byproduct of photosynthesis. Then intracellular transport means within the cytoplasm, lot of minerals are there present in the cytoplasm. So the movement or the transportation of these minerals molecules takes place by the process of diffusion throughout the cytoplasm, and this is how they are made available to different cell organelles for different functions. Like glucose is diffusing through the cytoplasm, and it is reaching to the mitochondria for respiration process. Then in the process of osmosis, it is the diffusion of water which is taking place in the process of osmosis. And we know that osmosis is very necessary process for the absorption of water in the plants, or movement of water from one cell to the other cell. Then the distribution of the substances. So in the distribution means water and solutes inside the plant, they are getting distributed when they are getting diffused through the cells. So by the diffusion of water and the substances from one cell to the other cell, from outside of the cell to the inside of the cell, then only the substances which are, like suppose in the cell the photosynthesis is taking place and the glucose is synthesized. So this glucose need to be distributed throughout the plant to different cells so that the plant can get energy. And so this distribution is possible only by diffusion, because when this glucose is diffused into the phloem cells, then only it is reaching to other parts of the plant. Similarly, transpiration. It is helpful in the transpiration. How? The water vapor which is released from the plant, it diffuses in the environment, and then only the transpiration takes place, and which is very necessary for maintenance of the water cycle. Then moistening of the cell wall. By the diffusion process only the cell wall remains moistened, and water from xylem channels is helping in keeping the cell walls moistening. Means suppose this is the stem and these are the xylem. So when the water is rising up in the xylem channel, it is being distributed into the neighboring cells. So this is how through the xylem water gets diffused into the cells and keep the cells moistened and hydrated. So these are all the significance of diffusion, and by this we have concluded our topic diffusion, and today we'll be studying up to here only. And I hope you all must have done your revision very nicely, because you got lot of time for class 10th preparation, remaining papers, and I hope, I wish that all should get 100% marks in bio. Okay, thank you.